Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for joining me this Sunday. I'm Frederica Whitfield. For the first time ever, the FBI has publicly released a highly sensitive FISA request. The more than 400-page surveillance warrant application is on Trump campaign foreign policy advisor Carter Page, listing him as an agent of foreign power. It is heavily redacted, but lays out why the FBI was allowed to conduct surveillance on Page starting in 2016. Carter Page himself reacting to the release for the first time on CNN this morning.
No, I've never been an agent of the foreign power in any by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, I sat in on some meetings, but you know, to call me an advisor, I think is way over the top.
And now we are finally getting to see some of the facts, the truth behind the previously classified document that triggered the memo wars on Capitol Hill, where both sides of the aisle released their own contradictory summaries of the warrant. Republicans accusing the FBI of abusing its surveillance powers. And now, after the release of the document, President Trump believes Republicans are vindicated. CNN is covering the story from all angles. CNN crime and justice reporter Shimon Prokopetz is standing by in Washington with a breakdown of the details of the warrant. CNN's Ryan Nobles is near Bedminster, New Jersey, where the president is spending the weekend and has his reaction. And we have Sean Turner, Bradley Moss, and Julian Zelitzer all here to analyze what all of this might mean. But first, let's listen to more of what Carter Page has to say about all of this on State of the Union with Jake Tapper today.
You did advise the Kremlin back in 2013 or 2012, somewhere in there.
Jake, it's really spin. I mean, I sat in on some meetings, but you know, to call me an advisor, I think is way over the top.
Except in a 2013 letter you wrote it says, quote, over the past half year, I have had the privilege to serve as an informal advisor to the staff of the Kremlin in preparation for the presidency of the G20 summit next month, where energy issues will be a prominent point on the agenda. That's August 2013. That's yourself calling yourself an informal advisor to the Kremlin.
You know, informal, having some conversations with people. I mean, this is really nothing and just an attempt to distract from the real crimes that are shown in this misleading document. You know, page 8, it says, it talks about disguised propaganda, including the planting of false or misleading articles, which is exactly what this is. So that's kind of the pot calling the kettle black by Mr. Comey.
It says, quote, the FBI believes Carter Page has been the subject of targeted recruitment by the Russian government, and then it's redacted, and then it says, undermine and influence the outcome of the 2016 U.S. presidential election in violation of U.S. criminal law. It says that the Russians were trying to recruit you. We know you said that you went to Russia in the summer of 2016 to deliver a commencement address. Is it not a possibility that Russians were trying to recruit you, even if you didn't take the bait? Is that not possible? It seems to me like that would be their job, and you were working for Trump. You'd worked with the Kremlin in the past. That would be a reasonable thing for them to try to do.
It's totally unreasonable, Jake, and it actually speaks to another misleading testimony related to the indictments that Eric Holder and Preet Bharara submitted on January 2015, talking about that prior case. And, you know, a lot of that is incorrect spin. That individual, Mr. Podobny, a young diplomat in New York, I talked with him about my class. You know, I sat, we had coffee one time. I met him at a conference at Asia Society. We met once for coffee, and I gave him some of my class notes, you know, that my students at New York University were looking at. And it was in one ear and out the other. He never asked me to do anything. I mean, it's just so preposterous.
Did anyone at any time, any Russian government official, at any time in 2016, talk to you about either lifting the sanctions or compromising material that they claim to have on Hillary Clinton?
On compromising material, not one word. I was hearing about things when you were hearing about things in the mainstream media. You know, look, I mean, when I was there in July of 2016, you know, a few people might have brought it up in passing. But, you know, again, it's a major economic issue. And so, you know, there may have been a loose conversation. I'm very careful in terms of, you know, making sure that there's a clear record. There was nothing in terms of any nefarious behavior.
Okay.
So that's Carter Page. Now, what about the details we're learning from this 400-page newly released FISA warrant? CNN's crime and justice reporter Shimon Prokopetz joins me now from Washington with more on this. So what stands out the most to you?
Well, Fred, certainly the fact that this is the first time in the FBI's history, in the Department of Justice history, that such a document is released. And really, it gives us an inside look at some of what the FBI was thinking, some of what the FBI was believing. And certainly the way they characterize Carter Page is significant. It goes on, though, they call him possibly a foreign agent. The different ways in which they describe in which he was communicating with the Russians and what they perhaps were trying to do to him. It says calling him there, that this target, he's the target of this application in the FISA court. And then it goes on to say that the FBI believes that Page has been the subject of targeted recruitment by the Russian government. And by that point, as we know, the FBI had, along with intelligence partners, certainly, there was a lot of concern that the Russians were trying to somehow influence, certainly, the Trump campaign and others, and perhaps cause harm to Hillary Clinton. But most significant, I think, Fred, is really finally how they describe Carter Page. And here's how they say, that the FBI believes that the Russian government's efforts are being coordinated with Page and perhaps other individuals associated with candidate number one's campaign, and that is the Trump campaign. You know, all along we have heard that perhaps there were people who were unwitting, who didn't know, who didn't think that the Russians were trying to do this. But this seems, certainly, this last line that I read here certainly seems to indicate that the FBI had reason to believe that Carter Page was working with the Russians in this effort and even others perhaps in the campaign. And significant in all this is that this is still an ongoing investigation. So all of that information, that they had other information perhaps to support this FISA, to support such a secret move by the FBI, we don't know. We also know that Robert Mueller, the special counsel, is still looking into all of this. So perhaps we'll learn more down the line. But certainly the way in which Carter Page is being described in all of this is extremely significant.
Mm-hmm. Shimon Prokopetz, thank you so much for that. All right, let's check in now with CNN's Ryan Nobles, who is near Trump's golf resort in Bedminster, New Jersey, where the president's spending the weekend. So tell us about the president's reaction and why he believes this is vindication.
Yeah, Fred, I mean, there's no doubt that the president is going to use the revelation of this document as an opportunity to further try and cast aspersions on the Mueller investigation. The president has fired off a number of tweets this morning talking about this particular issue and why, to your point, he believes this is another example of how the Mueller investigation is flawed and is essentially just out to get him. Let me read to you specifically one of the tweets from the president this morning. He said, quote, "Congratulations to Judicial Watch and Tom Fenton on being successful in getting the Carter Page FISA documents. As usual, they are ridiculously heavily redacted, but confirm with little doubt that the Department of Justice," and note he puts justice in quotes, "and the FBI misled the courts." And then he goes on to use his familiar refrain of witch hunt, rigged, and a scam. And basically, what the president is doing is he's using this as evidence to kind of play in line with the Republican talking point on this particular issue, that the FISA warrant application, which was designed to be able for the government to be able to conduct surveillance on Carter Page, was based on the fact that they were using this dossier, which was a collection of information about potential ties between the president and the Russian government. And the president has long called that particular dossier phony, and it shouldn't be used for anything, let alone the basis of a federal investigation. But it's important to point out, Fred, that the FBI clearly was interested in investigating Carter Page long before the revelation of that document. And another thing we should point out is that there are many prominent Republicans that disagree with the president's assessment of this document's release. Marco Rubio among them said that he read the document, and to him it appears that the government lawyers and the Justice Department did the correct accounting. They followed the law, they applied, and they were given the opportunity to conduct surveillance on Carter Page. And one other point we'll make, Fred, is that, you know, this FISA law has been on the books for some time, And the Congress has had multiple opportunities to rein it in a little bit, making it a little bit more difficult for the United States to conduct surveillance on its own citizens. And they have just decided not to do that. In fact, as late as the beginning of this year, they were confronted with that. They toyed with the idea, but ultimately just renewed the FISA law in its current form. And the President of the United States signed that into law. Fred?
All right, Ryan Nobles, thanks so much. All right, joining me right now to discuss this further, CNN national security analyst Sean Turner, Bradley Moss, a national security attorney and one of the lawyers who filed a lawsuit requesting the release of the FISA warrant, and CNN political analyst Julian Zelitzer. Good to see you both. All three of you, I should say. So, Bradley, let me begin with you. You know, your reaction to the release of this FISA application and what it says.
Well, look, this is an unprecedented moment. As they've been noting, you know, no one has ever before had a FISA warrant released. It's never been done through a legal process. And the only reason this probably ever came to light was because of the issuance of these two political memoranda. Controversial as they were, whether or not it should have been done is someone, you know, for someone else to decide. But when the president declassified the Nunes memo and when the Justice Department declassified in part the Schiff memo, it allowed for these documents to be published with all these redactions, admittedly. And now we have another fight, because now we have portions of these applications that have come out, all the open source info, all the Steele dossier information, but there's pages upon pages of classified information that's been redacted, that's government information, of confidential sources information that's been redacted. We don't know everything that actually went into this. We don't know the full story. We
just know the small piece. Do you believe it should be challenged? That unredacted version should be released?
Absolutely. We actually, when the government first issued this four-month time frame to produce these records back in March, we sent a letter to the president, care of Don McGahn in the White House Counsel's Office, begging him, saying, don't make the FBI go through this extensive four-month process. Declassify the entirety of the applications. You can make specific redactions for, you know, very specific sources and methods to protect lives, but give the public the full context here. He has not done that, and instead he's got a piece for his media narrative.
So then, Sean, what's the danger or perhaps, you know, real benefit of the release of this application, unredacted or otherwise? Do you have concerns about other applications, you know, forthcoming as a result of how this one is being handled?
Yeah, I take a very different approach to this. I think that it's unfortunate, potentially dangerous that we have gone down this path of not only releasing FISA documents, but also kind of delving into the work of the FISA court. Look, when the president and the Justice Department made the decision to release those earlier memos regarding this investigation, we talked about the fact that they were necessarily politicizing intelligence for their own purposes. The FISA court, the FISA process is a process that throughout the past, you know, several decades has allowed us to be able to identify threats to this nation, to be able to pursue avenues to prevent attacks on this nation in a way that we would not have been able to do had this law been had the information regarding this law and had these sorts of documents been made public. So I think that we're setting a dangerous precedent here. I completely understand and believe in the idea that we need to be more transparent, but I also think that as you look at these documents and you see that they are heavily redacted, I, as someone who spent time in the intelligence community, can read these documents and draw things from the redactions, and I think there are other smart people out there who can do the same thing. And the biggest concern that I have here is that when people know all about this process and know how this process works, this is the kind of thing that causes our adversaries to change their behavior. This is the kind of thing that makes it much more difficult for the intelligence community to be able to pursue individuals who are acting against this nation. So I do have real concerns about this.
So potentially just simply revealing too much. So Julian, some Republicans have accused the FBI of misleading the FISA court by, you know, presenting information from a former British spy who compiled that dossier on alleged, you know, Trump-Russia ties. So here is how so many have described that warrant in the past. Listen.
The FBI should not go to secret courts using information that was paid for by the Democrats to open up investigations and get warrants on people of the other political party. That's the type of stuff that happens in banana republics.
I think that the substance of this memo absolutely implicates senior officials at the Department of Justice and the FBI, and I think that it shows that the entire Mueller investigation should have never been started in the first place, that it is built on a false, rotten premise.
And that's why I'm very concerned if top people at the FBI took a campaign document into a court to get a warrant to spy on an American associated with the other campaign. I think that undermines the rule of law, and that's what I'm concerned about.
So, Julian, will the release now change any of those arguments?
It won't change the arguments, even though the document doesn't support the argument. The document, the parts that are redacted show there was probable cause. It shows that they identified what this document was, the Steele file, and they still moved forward. And we're talking about Republican judges who were involved in confirming this decision. That said, the facts don't matter. I think you're going to see the same argument from the president and the Republicans in an effort to question the legitimacy of the FBI and Robert Mueller.
Hmm. And so, Bradley, the president's already tweeted out vindication. Is this vindication?
No, not at all. And actually, those three clips you just played, that's all political pass blocking by members of Congress who are very clearly trying to protect the president to some extent here. Every single one of them made the same kind of argument, that the FBI somehow just went to the FISA court with only the dossier. But as Julian was just saying, these applications, which are each 100 pages long, have tons of information that has nothing to do with the dossier, but we don't know what it is because it's all classified. It was redacted as it would reveal confidential human sources. Until we know the full story, this media narrative will continue, and I think, unfortunately, that's why even this publication had to come out, just to give the public some context that there is more to this story than you're hearing from certain media outlets.
And Sean, you heard the former advisor, Carter Page, really digging in his heels earlier today. Senator Marco Rubio was on State of the Union this morning as well and had this to say about the surveillance of Carter Page.
By the Trump's campaign own admission, Carter Page was not a big player in their campaign. I don't believe that, them looking into Carter Page means they were spying on the campaign. I also don't believe it proves anything about collusion or anything like that. I think Carter Page is one of these guys that we never would have heard of him before all of this. But he was a guy that was on their screen even before the campaign. And when he comes into kind of the near orbit of a campaign, they get interested when they put that together with what's happening with Russian interference.
So described as a foreign agent, Carter Page, Sean, how suspicious are you of Carter Page? How much more convinced are you that this FISA application was appropriate for him?
Yeah, I think that prior to this FISA application coming out, there were people in the national security space, myself included, who believed that there was a possibility that Carter Page was particularly naive and unwitting of Russia's efforts to infiltrate the campaign and to use him as an option to do that. Now that I've read this document, it's clear that Carter Page was not unwitting, that he was clearly that he clearly knew what was happening. The document talks about how he knowingly established relationships with Russian intelligence officers. This morning, he said it was unreasonable that the Russians would try to co-opt him as a agent of the Russian government. So I think that the days of giving him some sort of benefit of the doubt are over. It's clear that he had some understanding of what he was doing, and I think that there's probably a lot more information that would help paint this picture in the parts of this document that are redacted.
Mm. All right, Sean Turner, Julian Zelitzer, Bradley Moss, we'll leave it there for now. Thanks so much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
All right, next, remember this moment when the U.S. Director of National Intelligence appears to be blindsided by news that the Trump administration had invited Russia's president to the White House. Well, now, guess what? He's the one apologizing. But why? This as Republican Senator Lindsey Graham calls for Trump to get tougher on Putin and issue more sanctions. Plus, a disturbing report reveals a rideshare driver exposed personal moments of customers live on the internet. Some of it included their full names and addresses. Details coming up. All right, welcome back. Director of National Intelligence Dan Coats is apologizing for his public reaction when told that President Trump had invited Russian President Vladimir Putin to the White House in the fall. At a public event, Coats appeared to mock the idea of Putin coming to the U.S. In his apology, Coats said, "Some press coverage has mischaracterized my intentions in responding to breaking news presented to me during a live interview. My admittedly awkward response was in no way meant to be disrespectful or criticize the actions of the president. I want to bring in Susan Glasser. She is a CNN Global Affairs analyst and a staff writer at The New Yorker. Good to see you. So let's begin with this apology. Why did Mr. Coates feel like he needed to handle it this way?
Well, it's a very interesting question. As you note, it didn't take place right away, this apology. It came a couple days after he made those remarks during the live interview when he was informed about President Trump's surprise decision to invite Vladimir Putin to the White House this fall. So I guess the question is, did other advisors close to the president suggest that President Trump is still angry with former Senator Coates? Does it mean that his job is in jeopardy in some way and he's trying to save it? That would be the obvious implication from it, but it's also a carefully worded statement. He didn't say, I take back my concern about the way in which the meeting was handled. He told Andrea Mitchell in that interview that he would not have advised the president to have this meeting or to have the private one-on-one with Vladimir Putin. So he didn't take back that or apologize for that, interestingly.
Yeah, it kind of leads you to just kind of extrapolate and think about which portions might he be reflecting on based on what kind of pressure he may have, received, or feedback he may have received. So I want to look at now how President Trump's performance in Helsinki is being received and evaluated. A new Washington Post poll found that overall 33% of Americans approve of Trump's handling of this meeting with Putin, while 50% disapprove. But if you dig a little deeper, 66% of Republicans say they approve of his performance, while just 8% of Democrats think the same. So clearly the division, along party lines continues. But does this mean that, Trump has anything to worry about in terms of how he is forging ahead with this relationship with Putin?
Well, look, the numbers, as you said, suggest a division between the two parties. And right now, it's very hard to get people to change their mind about President Trump, even when he does things that are seen as outrageous or totally beyond the pale in a policy sense. People still have such fixed views on him. Republicans have stuck with him, Democrats have not. But I'm struck by that 66% GOP approved number. Remember that President Trump's overall approval ratings among Republicans are much higher than that right now. And so actually it reflects, I think, some at least of the party's traditional skepticism of Russia. Remember, this was, until Donald Trump, the party of residual Cold War hawks, the Republican Party. And so that 66% number is actually much lower than President Trump gets approval on most other issues. So that's something for him to worry about. And Republicans on Capitol Hill have made it clear this week that they're not really on board with President Trump's renewed opening. You mentioned Senator Lindsey Graham suggesting maybe even new sanctions need to be imposed on Russia if it continues.
In fact, this is Lindsey Graham on that very issue. Listen.
Just have sanctions that can fall on Russia like a hammer. Do not meet with this guy from a position of weakness. You need to do two things. You need to harden our electoral infrastructure, and you need to be the leader of that movement, and you need to work with Congress to come up with new sanctions, because Putin's not getting the message.
And then one has to wonder whether the president's going to take that advice, because, so many in his circle say he doesn't really take advice. So is that really, Lindsey Graham speaking for he and on behalf of Congress, who already acted to put new sanctions on Russia last year, even though, it took many months for those sanctions to be enacted?
Well, that's right. I think you're right to be skeptical about whether President Trump is listening to Lindsey Graham or anybody else. In fact, Lindsey Graham also said in that interview, and I thought it was really important, he still doesn't know, as do apparently even the rest of the government, what was actually said or agreed to in the private meeting between President Trump and President Putin. This is 1 week after the summit. We still don't know what actually was agreed upon.
Susan Glasser, thank you so much. Good to see you. All right, still ahead. In public, the president is touting the so-called success of relations with North Korea, but in private, he's reportedly frustrated over the lack of progress his administration is meeting. What does this mean for a potential deal for denuclearization? We explore next.
The 7 hours of sleep support. Number one sleep doctor recommended, Remfresh, your nightly sleep companion.
All right, welcome back. President Trump is apparently frustrated with the lack of progress with North Korea. The Washington Post is reporting that the president is complaining about the real lack of progress after he declared the threat of nuclear war was gone following his summit with Kim Jong-un of North Korea. With me now is CNN's global affairs correspondent Elise Labid. So, Elise, in the past few weeks, we've seen several canceled meetings, including one between the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, and Kim Jong-un that simply didn't materialize. So is this the North Koreans, you know, their way of kind of playing a game here?
Well, Fred, it's really about the North Koreans setting the pace for the process of implementation of this agreement with President Trump that they had in Singapore. Obviously, Secretary Pompeo went to North Korea expecting that there would be some kind of meeting with Kim Jong-un. That never took place. Excuse me. That never took place. And then all of a sudden, there was supposed to be a meeting on the remains of U.S. soldiers, which was supposed to be a kind of show of good faith of the North Koreans. That didn't take place. President Trump, we understand, has griped in meetings to officials about the slow pace of progress. Still, he does think it's a good sign that the North Koreans have not tested any nuclear or missile tests in many months. Take a listen to General Vincent Brooks. Now, he's the commander of the U.S. forces in Korea, who also is President Trump's nominee to be ambassador to South Korea, saying that diplomacy takes time and a process is underway.
Our expectations have to be tempered properly. Diplomacy is a process that takes time, it takes engagement, and it's founded on dialogue and then trust. So the great news is dialogue has opened. There's much posturing, there's much sensing, and there has to be sufficient room for our diplomats, especially our Secretary of State, Secretary Pompeo, to be able to gain the traction and find the opportunity and be able to maneuver toward the outcomes we all seek.
Now, Fred, yes, a process is underway, but this is really the North Koreans' kind of playbook here. They draw it out, they try and do as little as possible, and there could be this ongoing process with no implementation of the agreement with President Trump.
So it is going to come down to whether there really can be an agreement at all on what denuclearization really means.
Well, yes, that's one of the hang-ups. What does denuclearization mean to the North Koreans? To the U.S., it means complete, final, irreversible. I think, Fred, the real question is whether the North Koreans have made what they call that strategic choice to give up its nuclear weapons. They said that they did at the summit, but there's really no indication that they're doing anything towards implementing that agreement. The question, I think, Fred, is they're willing to do anything at all. They'll do as little as they can to get as much as they can from the U.S.
All right, Elise Labid, thanks so much. All right, still ahead. Moments of privacy broadcast live on the internet. A rideshare driver is in the hot seat now after allegedly exposing customers' intimate moments and conversations online.
On Pro. Pay no more than $25 per dose with copay card.
Think what you say and do inside a rideshare with companies like Uber and Lyft is private? Well, not so fast. A new report from the St. Louis Post-Dispatch reveals a rideshare driver was live streaming very personal video of his riders for online entertainment. CNN's Polo Sandoval has more on all of this for us. So, Polo, exactly what was revealed?
So, Fred, this story is raising a wide range of legal and ethical privacy questions. The St. Louis Post-Dispatch initially reported earlier this weekend that a 32-year-old man in that general area had been essentially streaming using the application Twitch some of these fares that he was accepting while working with Lyft and with Uber. We've blurred some of the video there, but you can clearly see how the interior of this pickup truck has been lit so that he, in essence, could provide that clear picture for viewers around the world, whoever was logging in, with the exchanges that were happening, the conversations that were happening with his customer. So why did he do this? I can tell you that the St. Louis Post-Dispatch did speak to him directly, and he said that it was mainly because of security reasons, so that he could potentially feel protected while he's doing these Uber and these Lyft rides. That is the biggest reason. But at the same time, in the Post reporting, he also says that he was trying to, in his own words, capture the natural interactions between himself and those passengers. But again, the primary reason is for security. Ultimately, though, Lyft and Uber have released statements. They have said that they have essentially cut ties with this individual and have suspended his ability to accept some of these fares. And when you look at some of the policies that these rideshare programs have in place, there certainly is some wiggle room there. For example, Uber has on their website for the general public the answer to this question of whether or not their drivers can use video cameras, and they say that they can use or they can install video cameras as long as it's for the purposes of safety. However, it also encourages drivers to check with local regulations, with state laws, because it's important to point out where this video was shot. It is a one-party state, which basically requires that only one person in audio and video recordings give consent, the other person not so much. So that is the big question here, Fred. What is the reasonable expectation of privacy when you jump in an Uber? That's what we're speaking to attorneys right now to try to get you an answer on.
All right, new concerns now. Polo Sandoval, thank you so much.
You bet.
All right, next. Is the Trump-Putin debacle causing some Trump supporters to have doubts ahead of the midterm elections? Details on that straight ahead.
The Wild, Alaska, tomorrow at 7 on CNN.
All right, a programming note for you. Be sure to catch an all-new episode of The 2000s. This episode takes a look at the challenges facing President George W. Bush and his second term, challenges like the insurgency in Iraq, the financial meltdown, and Hurricane Katrina.
Katrina exposes this city's worst nightmare, the very waterways on which New Orleans has lived and worked and thrived for centuries, now threaten to drown it. The city center, surrounded by protective levees, could fill up like a bathtub with storm surge.
Ladies and gentlemen, I wish I had better news for you, but we are facing a storm that most of us have feared. A mandatory evacuation order is hereby called for all of the parish of Orleans.
This storm is now the size of the state of Florida. It will be in the top five in terms of strength to ever hit the United States.
By the time the mayor declared an evacuation, it was too late.
Thousands of people have been in line for hours here at the Superdome, where 30,000 people may end up spending the night inside this giant shelter that officials are confident will hold up.
And see how President Bush led the nation in these hardships. Watch the 2000s tonight, 9, right here on CNN. Right, the past week has not been a smooth one for President Donald Trump. Backlash over his summit with Russian President Vladimir Putin is not just coming from Democrats, it's also coming from other Americans. According to a new poll, 50% of the country disapproves of the way President Trump handled the summit. 33% had no problem with it at all. But the polls skew more towards President Trump's favor when you ask voters 65 and older. 41% approve of the way he handled the meeting. 47% disapprove. CNN national correspondent Gary Tuchman visited a retirement community in Florida, a GOP stronghold, and voters were eager to speak their minds about what went down in Helsinki.
The Villages, Florida, is a popular place for Republicans to retire, making it easy to find people who voted for Donald Trump for president. But for some Trump voters, things went south this week, especially following President Trump's presentation as he stood next to Russian President Vladimir Putin.
He's an embarrassment to me. And as a Republican, I still feel that, you know, I just wish he would just learn to say things properly, and maybe he wouldn't get himself into so much trouble.
On this day, hundreds of Republicans in the Villages showed up at a forum attended by Florida candidates for governor, which was a good place to ask Trump voters about what happened in Finland.
When Donald Trump said there is blame for the United States as well as Russia, he could blame on this country, does that trouble you?
It's Donald Trump.
You know, you sort of expect that.
But does that trouble you? Do you think the United States should be blamed?
No, I don't think the United States should be blamed.
So should Donald Trump not have said that about his country?
He says a lot of stuff he should not say.
But then there are Trump voters like Dick Hoffman.
I think he's doing a wonderful job. I love the fact that he just plays the press like a Stradivarius.
Voters who say the president has nothing to apologize for. Are you a little uncomfortable with how comfortable he was with Vladimir Putin?
Didn't bother me a bit.
You didn't think it was deferential to him?
What went on in their meeting before that?
Well, no one does, and that's the problem, except for Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin.
Okay, I have faith in him.
What Donald Trump said when he was standing next to Vladimir Putin was, regarding meddling, Russian meddling, he goes, I will tell you that President Putin was extremely strong and powerful in his denial today. So what does that mean to you, strong and powerful? What did he say that was so powerful that convinced Donald Trump that...
He's strong and powerful in the way he said it. I mean, you...
Does that sound a bit creepy to you for Donald Trump to be talking about the Russian leader, strong and powerful? I mean,
the way you're questioning me with that, you're questioning me in a very strong and powerful way. No, I don't see that as a big deal.
Many of the Republicans here have been alive for 13 presidents. They've seen a lot. And some, while continuing to support their president and their party, are a bit wistful. You were born when FDR was president. You've seen FDR, you've seen Truman, you've seen Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, up until Donald Trump today. You said you love Donald Trump, but would you be more comfortable if Ronald Reagan or Dwight Eisenhower were president today?
If Ronald Reagan were to run again, yeah.
Viewpoints from Republicans in America's largest retirement community. Gary Tuchman, CNN, The Villages, Florida.
All right, still to come. For the first time ever, the FBI has publicly released a FISA surveillance warrant, and it's all about Trump campaign foreign policy advisor Carter Page, what it means for the president, and the Russia investigation coming up.
Pro Prime Time, tomorrow night at 9 Eastern on CNN.
All right, President Trump is planning to liven up one of the most recognizable plane designs in the world. That's this week's State of the Cartoonian. Here's Jake Tapper.
Air Force One is getting a makeover, and President Trump's design ideas are already taking off.
Air Force One is going to be incredible. It's going to be the top of the line.
First on Trump's list, nix the colors selected by the Kennedys in 1962.
I wonder if we should use the same baby blue colors, and we're not.
Oh, I think it's lovely. I hate to make changes, really.
The president says he wants to go with something a little more, on the nose.
You know the colors we're using? Take a guess. Red, white, and blue.
Another idea, perhaps? The former real estate developer is known for selecting only the finest materials, maybe a solid gold plane and marble for the wings.
I want the plane to be immaculate. I want everything polished.
Though perhaps that's not the most aerodynamic idea.
Please prepare for landing.
Of course, the president could just go with his favorite image.
Do I look like a president? How handsome am I, right? How handsome?
On the other hand, there is already a famous plane with a red, white, and blue design. Perhaps the president got some inspiration on the tarmac in Helsinki.
I think I could have a very good relationship with Russia and with President Putin.
Спасибо большое.
Oh my, we will...
Refresh, your nightly sleep companion.
All right, welcome back. President Trump is apparently frustrated with the lack of progress with North Korea. The Washington Post is reporting that the president is complaining about the real lack of progress after he declared the threat of nuclear war was gone following his summit with Kim Jong-un of North Korea. With me now is CNN's global affairs correspondent Elise Labid. So, Elise, in the past few weeks, we've seen several canceled meetings, including one between the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, and Kim Jong-un that simply didn't materialize. So is this the North Koreans, you know, their way of kind of playing a game here?
Well, Fred, it's really about the North Koreans setting the pace for the process of implementation of this agreement with President Trump that they had in Singapore. Obviously, Secretary Pompeo went to North Korea expecting that there would be some kind of meeting with Kim Jong-un. That never took place. Excuse me, that never took place. And then all of a sudden, there was supposed to be a meeting on the remains of U.S. soldiers, which was supposed to be a kind of show of good faith of the North Koreans. That didn't take place. President Trump, we understand, has griped in meetings to officials about the slow pace of progress. Still, he does think it's a good sign that the North Koreans have not tested any nuclear or missile tests in many months. Take a listen to General Vincent Brooks. Now, he's the commander of the U.S. forces in Korea, who also is President Trump's nominee to be ambassador to South Korea, saying that diplomacy takes time and a process is underway.
Our expectations have to be tempered properly. Diplomacy is a process that takes time, it takes engagement, and it's founded on dialogue and then trust. So the great news is dialogue has opened. There's much posturing, there's much sensing, and there has to be sufficient room for our diplomats, especially our Secretary of State, Secretary Pompeo, to be able to gain the traction and find the opportunity and be able to maneuver toward the outcomes we all seek.
Now, Fred, yes, a process is underway, but this is really the North Koreans' kind of playbook here. They draw it out, they try and do as little as possible, and there could be this ongoing process with no implementation of the agreement with President Trump.
So it is going to come down to whether there really can be an agreement at all on what denuclearization really means.
Well, yes, that's one of the hang-ups. What does denuclearization mean to the North Koreans? To the U.S., it means complete, final, irreversible. I think, Fred, the real question is whether the North Koreans have made what they call that strategic choice to give up its nuclear weapons. They said that they did at the summit, but there's really no indication that they're doing anything towards implementing that agreement. The question, I think, Fred, is they're willing to do anything at all. They'll do as little as they can to get as much as they can from the U.S.
All right, Elise Labatt, thanks so much. All right, still ahead. Moments of privacy broadcast live on the internet. A rideshare driver is in the hot seat now after allegedly exposing customers' intimate moments and conversations online.
On Pro. Pay no more than $25 per dose with copay card.
Think what you say and do inside a rideshare with companies like Uber and Lyft is private? Well, not so fast. A new report from the St. Louis Post-Dispatch reveals a rideshare driver was live streaming very personal video of his riders for online entertainment. CNN's Polo Sandoval has more on all of this for us. So, Polo, exactly what was revealed?
So, Fred, this story is raising a wide range of legal and ethical privacy questions. The St. Louis Post-Dispatch initially reported earlier this weekend that a 32-year-old man in that general area had been essentially streaming using the application Twitch some of these fares that he was accepting while working with Lyft and with Uber. We've blurred some of the video there, but you can clearly see how the interior of this pickup truck has been lit so that he, in essence, could provide that clear picture for viewers around the world, whoever was logging in, with the exchanges that were happening, the conversations that were happening with his customer. So why did he do this? I can tell you that the St. Louis Post-Dispatch did speak to him directly, and he said that it was mainly because of security reasons, so that he could potentially feel protected while he's doing these Uber and these Lyft rides. That is the biggest reason. But at the same time, in the Post reporting, he also says that he was trying to, in his own words, capture the natural interactions between himself and those passengers. But again, the primary reason is for security. Ultimately, though, Lyft and Uber have released statements. They have said that they have essentially cut ties with this individual and have suspended his ability to accept some of these fares. And when you look at some of the policies that these rideshare programs have in place, there certainly is some wiggle room there. For example, Uber has on their website for the general public the answer to this question of whether or not their drivers can use video cameras, and they say that they can use or they can install video cameras as long as it's for the purposes of safety. However, it also encourages drivers to check with local regulations, with state laws, because it's important to point out where this video was shot, it is a one-party state, which basically requires that only one person in audio and video recordings give consent. The other other person not so much. So that is the big question here, Fred. What is the reasonable expectation of privacy when you jump in an Uber? That's what we're speaking to attorneys right now to try to get you an answer on.
All right, new concerns now. Polo Sandoval, thank you so much.
You bet.
All right, next. Is the Trump-Putin debacle causing some Trump supporters to have doubts ahead of the midterm elections? Details on that straight ahead.
The Wild, Alaska, tomorrow at 7 on CNN.
All right, a programming note for you. Be sure to catch an all-new episode of The 2000s. This episode takes a look at the challenges facing President George W. Bush and his second term, challenges like the insurgency in Iraq, the financial meltdown, and Hurricane Katrina.
Katrina exposes this city's worst nightmare, the very waterways on which New Orleans has lived and worked and thrived for centuries, now threaten to drown it. The city center, surrounded by protective levees, could fill up like a bathtub with storm surge.
Ladies and gentlemen, I wish I had better news for you, but we are facing a storm that most of us have feared. A mandatory evacuation order is hereby called for all of the parish of Orleans.
This storm is now the size of the state of Florida. It will be in the top five in terms of strength to ever hit the United States.
By the time the mayor declared an evacuation, it was too late.
Thousands of people have been in line for hours here at the Superdome, where 30,000 people may end up spending the night inside this giant shelter that officials are confident will hold up.
And see how President Bush led the nation in these hardships. Watch the 2000s tonight, 9, right here on CNN. All right, the past week has not been a smooth one for President Donald Trump. Backlash over his summit with Russian President Vladimir Putin is not just coming from Democrats. It's also coming from other Americans. According to a new poll, 50% of the country disapproves of the way President Trump handled the summit. 33% had no problem with it at all. But the polls skew more towards President Trump's favor when you ask voters 65 and older. 41% approve of the way he handled the meeting. 47% disapprove. CNN national correspondent Gary Tuchman visited a retirement community in Florida, a GOP stronghold, and voters were eager to speak their minds about what went down in Helsinki.
The Villages, Florida, is a popular place for Republicans to retire, making it easy to find people who voted for Donald Trump for president. But for some Trump voters, things went south this week, especially following President Trump's presentation as he stood next to Russian President Vladimir Putin.
He's an embarrassment to me. And as a Republican, I still feel that, you know, I just wish he would just learn to say things properly and maybe he wouldn't get himself into so much trouble.
On this day, hundreds of Republicans in the Villages showed up at a forum attended by Florida candidates for governor, which was a good place to ask Trump voters about what happened in Finland. When Donald Trump said there is blame for the United States as well as Russia, he could blame on this country, does that trouble you?
It's Donald Trump. You know, you sort of expect that.
But does that trouble you? Do you think the United States should be blamed?
No, I don't think the United States should be blamed.
So should Donald Trump not have said that about his country?
He says a lot of stuff he should not say.
But then there are Trump voters like Dick Hoffman.
I think he's doing a wonderful job. I love the fact that he just plays the press like a Stradivarius.
Voters who say the president has nothing to apologize for. Are you a little uncomfortable with how comfortable he was with Vladimir Putin?
Didn't bother me a bit.
You didn't think it was deferential to him?
I don't know what went on in their meeting before that.
Well, no one does, and that's the problem, except for Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin.
Okay, I have faith in him.
What Donald Trump said when he was standing next to Vladimir Putin was, regarding meddling, Russian meddling, he goes, I will tell you that President Putin was extremely strong and powerful in his denial today. So what does that mean to you, strong and powerful? What did he say that was so powerful that convinced Donald Trump that...
He's strong and powerful in the way he said it. I mean,
does that sound a bit creepy to you for Donald Trump to be talking about the Russian leader, strong and powerful? I mean,
the way you're questioning me with that, you're questioning me in a very strong and powerful way. No, I don't see that as a big deal.
Many of the Republicans here have been alive for 13 presidents. They've seen a lot. And some, while continuing to support their president and their party, are a bit wistful.
You were born when FDR was president. You've seen FDR. You've seen Truman. You've seen Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, up until Donald Trump today. You said you love Donald Trump, but would you be more comfortable if Ronald Reagan or Dwight Eisenhower were president today?
If Ronald Reagan were to run again, yeah.
Viewpoints from Republicans in America's largest retirement community. Gary Tuchman, CNN, The Villages, Florida.
All right, still to come. For the first time ever, the FBI has publicly released a FISA surveillance warrant, and it's all about Trump campaign foreign policy advisor Carter Page, what it means for the president, and the Russia investigation coming up.
Pro Prime Time, tomorrow night at 9 Eastern on CNN.
All right, President Trump is planning to liven up one of the most recognizable plane designs in the world. That's this week's State of the Cartoonian. Here's Jake Tapper.
Air Force One is getting a makeover, and President Trump's design ideas are already taking off.
Air Force One is going to be incredible. It's going to be the top of the line.
First on Trump's list, nix the colors selected by the Kennedys in 1962.
I wonder if we should use the same baby blue colors, and we're not.
Oh, I think it's lovely. I hate to make changes, really.
The president says he wants to go with something a little more, on the nose.
You know what colors we're using? Take a guess. Red, white, and blue.
Another idea, perhaps? The former real estate developer is known for selecting only the finest materials, maybe a solid gold plane and marble for the wings.
I want the plane to be immaculate. I want everything polished.
Though perhaps that's not the most aerodynamic idea.
Please prepare for landing.
Of course, the president could just go with his favorite image.
Do I look like a president? How handsome am I, right? How handsome?
On the other hand, there is already a famous plane with a red, white, and blue design. Perhaps the president got some inspiration on the tarmac in Helsinki.
I think I could have a very good relationship with Russia and with President Putin.
Спасибо большое.
Oh my, we will.